Hello. The purpose of this first video is to get to know the general definition of a vector space and to study a couple of important examples of vector spaces, which we'll also continue to study throughout this course. Vector spaces are a very familiar topic from linear algebra. Especially the Euclidean spaces are very important examples of vector spaces. More generally, vector space is an algebraic structure which is defined axiomatically. And this structure consists of a set X, a field of scalars, in our case, typically the field of complex numbers C, and two different operations defined on elements of X. And these operations are the vector addition, that is the summing of two vectors together, and scalar multiplication, that is the vector can be multiplied with a scalar or scaled. The axioms that these two operations need to satisfy are again very similar to the familiar properties of vectors on Euclidean spaces. Especially, the vector addition should be commutative and associative. The scalar multiplication should be associative. And these two operations should be distributive. Moreover, the vector space needs to contain a zero element, which is precisely the so-called neutral element of the addition. Meaning that if we add the zero element to a vector x, then this doesn't change the vector. And in addition, every element should have an inverse element with respect to the addition, meaning that if we add the vector and its inverse element together, we get the zero element. And finally, axioms 6 and 7 tell us how the multiplication with scalars 0 and 1 affect the vector. And in particular, the multiplication of any vector with the zero scalar should produce the zero element. So here in axiom 7, on the left, the zero symbol is the scalar complex number 0. And on the right, this is the zero element of the vector space. Later on this course, we'll put different kinds of additional structure on the vector space, especially norms and inner products. But we'll first consider the very basic properties of this general structure. And one of the essential properties of a vector space is that if we take two vectors x and y, then also the sum x plus y is in the same space x. And this follows from the general assumption that the vector addition maps from the product space x times x to x. And in this situation, we say that x is closed under addition. And similarly, the space is closed under the scalar multiplication, meaning that alpha x belongs to the space x whenever x is a vector and alpha is a scalar. And these two properties also have an immediate consequence that the vector space is closed under taking finite linear combinations. And as we remember, linear combination is a sum of a finite number of vectors xk multiplied by some scalar values alpha k. And on this course, we often use the large sigma notation for the summation, meaning simply that all of these terms are summed together. And this kind of a linear combination is indeed always in the space X, because our basic properties say that all of the terms alpha k xk belong to the space because of the closeness under scaling. and then the closeness of the under vector addition lets us easily deduce that sum of two such terms is in the space X, and consequently that the sum of three terms is in the space, and so on. On the remainder of this video, we'll study two particular vector spaces which are important for us on this course. The first one of these is a space of continuous functions, and it also represents a more general class of function spaces which we'll encounter in many forms on this course. And for a given subset omega of the Euclidean space Rn, this particular space is defined as the set of all complex valued functions f which are continuous on the set omega. And here continuity of f is of course defined exactly as usual for functions of a vector variable. And this set indeed becomes a vector space if we define the addition of two functions in a pointwise manner, meaning that the value of the sum of these functions is defined to be the sum of the values of these functions at a given point. And scaling of a function is defined in a similar way by simply multiplying all of the values of the function with the scalar alpha. A couple of notes are in order here, namely that if the dimension n of the Euclidean space is equal to 1, and if the set omega is an interval, then it's more typical in the lecture notes for us to use the letter I instead of omega. And it's also easy to see that we could generalize this space by instead considering functions of with vector values instead of scalar values, as long as all the functions in the same function space map into the same Euclidean space. But on this course we'll only be considering examples of vector spaces with scalar valued functions. And if we want to verify that C omega is a vector space, we'll first note that both of these operations are well defined, in the sense that the summation of two continuous functions results in a continuous function, which is again in this space C omega. And similarly, the multiplication by scalar is done in the way which results in a continuous function whenever f is continuous. The rest of the axioms in the definition can also be checked in a straightforward way. The commutativity, associativity, and distributivity are quite easy to prove just based on the definitions of the addition and the scalar multiplication. For a zero element in the axioms, we have a good candidate, which is namely the continuous function which has the zero value everywhere on omega. And indeed, if we add this function to any other continuous function f, according to the definition of vector addition, we again get the original function f. Moreover, this zero element is also compatible with axiom 7, since if we multiply any function f with the zero scalar, we get a function which has zero values everywhere, which means that we end up precisely with the zero element, as we should. Moreover, for any function f, we can define another continuous function g, which at each point theta has the value minus f at zeta. And if we add these two functions together, f and g, we end up with, again, with a function which has zero values everywhere, which means that the sum of f and g is the zero element of the space. And this means that the axiom 4 holds and the inverse element with respect to the addition of f is given by this function g that we defined. And finally, axiom 6 is very easy to prove as well. This property of multiplication with the scalar 1. Now we'll turn to another class of examples of vector spaces, which is also important for us on this course. And these are so-called sequence spaces. As a bit of a background, we can recall that the Euclidean spaces Rn and Cn are indeed vector spaces. And here the vector addition is defined in an element-wise manner. And scalar multiplication is defined so that the scalar multiplies each of the elements of the vector. And we can use exactly the same kind of an approach to define addition and scalar multiplication for infinite sequences of complex numbers xk. And for this, we define the space LC of infinite sequences as shown here. And so every element of this set LC is a sequence which is typically denoted as shown here. So x is equal to the sequence with elements xk. And the sequence is completely determined by its elements, including the order in which they appear in the sequence. The addition and scaling of the sequences we define in, again, in an element-wise manner, so that the sequence x plus y is a sequence whose kth element is equal to the sum of the kth elements of the sequences x and y. Likewise, the sequence alpha x we define as a sequence where each element xk is multiplied with the common scalar alpha. And since the addition and scalar multiplication of these infinite sequences are very similar to those on Euclidean spaces, it's very possible and also often very useful to consider the sequence X to be a vector with an infinite number of elements, xk. And we can think of these vectors to be either column or row vectors. This doesn't make any difference as long as we use the same interpretation for all of the elements in the same space. So that these vector operations are well defined. And for proving that LC is a vector space, the verification of the required axioms is very easy, simply based on the definitions of the operations. And in particular, the zero element is given by the sequence whose all elements are the zero scalars. And for a given sequence X, the inverse element with respect to the addition is a sequence whose all elements are multiplied with the scalar minus one. And this brings us to the end of the first video. And throughout the course, we'll very often see these two examples of vector spaces that we studied here, and other similar instances of function spaces and sequence spaces with different types of characteristic features.